Commission, Thursday, May 26th, the time is 3 p.m. I would make the announcement that the meeting is being recorded for the purposes of minutes. Is there anybody else recording the meeting besides the Commission? Thank you. Please, if you have a phone, turn it to the silent mode, and if you must take a phone call, please go outside the doors. Thank you. Mr. Secretary, will you call the roll?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Finance Department, Royden Richardson.
Present.
Warren Richard Conner.
Here.
Brewster Elizabeth Taylor.
Present.
Chatham Michael Skelly.
Here.
Dennis Richard Roy.
Present.
East End Joy Brookshire. Falmouth Charles McCaffrey.
Here.
Howard Jacqueline Edston.
Present.
Mashpee Ernest Vigilio.
Here.
Orleans Lynn Short.
Here.
Provincetown John Krivojic.
Here.
Sandwich Harold Mitchell.
Here.
Truro Kevin Grunwald.
Here.
Wellfleet Kevin, I mean Roger Putnam, sorry Roger.
I'm here.
Yarmouth John McCormick Jr., I'm here. County Commissioner Mary Pat Flynn.
Here.
Minority Representative John Harris.
Here.
Native American Representative David Whedon.
Here.
Governor's appointee is vacant. We have a quorum, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. At this time, I would ask anybody that has a public comment to make that has nothing to do with anything on the agenda. Now is the time to do that. Seeing none, we will move on. Christy, would you please give us the executive director?
Sure. Thank you, Mr. Chair. I do have a few items to update you on today. We will be having our third annual wastewater conference. So the One Cape Summit will be held on June 23rd and 24th at the Resort and Conference Center in Hyannis. Registration is open. The link is on the main page of our website. Kurt Spalding, who's the Region 1 EPA Administrator, will be speaking on the first day, late morning on June 23rd. And there will be a dinner that's going to be endorsed in the evening by the Selectmen and Counselors Association. This year's conference focus will be more on implementing solutions for clean water, so progress to date, technologies, updates, monitoring, and implementation plans for wastewater and watershed planning over the next 12 months. The Commission was recently awarded an Environmental Merit Award by the Environmental Protection Agency for the work on the 208 plan update, and so on May 10th, Erin Perry and Tom Cambrary went to Boston to accept that award with a few other staff members on behalf of the Commission. Just a few presentations that staff have undertaken over the last few weeks. Paul Nidzwicki spoke to the Community Leadership Institute on May 12th about the role of the Commission and how it serves Cape residents. He was also the keynote speaker at the Massachusetts Association of Planning Directors meeting on May 19th. He also presented some information relative to age demographics and the Cape economy at the May 13th Cape Cod Selectmen and Counselors Association. And today he's actually on the housing panel at the Cape Cod Young Professionals Shape Your Cape Summit, so he unfortunately is not here for your meeting today, as that panel is exactly the same time. Just a couple of staff additions. I just wanted to welcome Mario Carloni. He's actually sitting in the back. If you just want to stand up and introduce. He has joined the Commission staff as our geospatial developer. Prior to coming to the Commission, Mario was a data science consultant for 2 years, creating statistical dashboards for the medical and manufacturing industry. He is a UMass Dartmouth political science graduate. And while at UMass, Mario was a research analyst at the Public Policy Center. So we want to welcome Mario to the staff. And you also probably have read in the press recently that Heather Harper, Thelma's assistant town manager, will be joining the Commission at the end of the month as our new community design affordable housing specialist. Heather has a master's degree in regional planning. She'll be an asset to our community design and housing programs. And then lastly, at the next Commission meeting, Paul wanted to address the Commission and just give you an update, kind of a preview for what you might see at the Wastewater Summit, and give you some an overview of the 208 implementation to date and next steps. So thank you, Mr. Chair.
Thank you, Chris. At this time, I would request a motion for approval of the minutes of April 28th, 2016, the Commission workshop meeting.
Mr. Chairman, excuse me, I have a correction. On page three, under new business, it says, Jack McCormick welcomed and asked the recently appointed commissioners, et cetera, et cetera. I think Chairman Richard Roy introduced them.
We can make that.
We can make that change.
The minutes as amended.
Have a motion to approve the minutes as amended?
Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Any abstentions?
Yeah, I wasn't there.
One abstention.
One abstention. At this time, I would like to call on Ernest Rogelio to make its recommendation for a slate of offices. Ernie?
Mr. Chairman, the nominee committee consisted of Len Short, Jack McCormick, and myself. The nominating committee met on April 7th and again earlier today for the purpose of nominating a slate of Cape Cod commission officers for the term beginning July 1, 2016 through June 30, 2017. The committee's recommendation for a slate of commission officers is as follows. Harold Mitchell as chair, Jack McCormick as vice chair, and Roger Putnam as secretary.
Thank you. At this time, I would ask, are there any further nominations from the floor? I see none. Could I have a motion to close nominations? Second?
Second.
Moved and seconded to close nominations. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Any abstentions? Okay, the nominations are closed. The election will be conducted at our scheduled commission meeting on June 9th. Now I'd like to open a public hearing. This hearing is for the Cape Cod Commission to consider a development of regional impact exemption application for the following project. Project name, Mid-Cape Main Replacement Project, Cape Cod Commission file number 16010. Project applicant is National Grid. Project site locations, the towns of Yarmouth, Dennis, Harwich, and Brewster. Project description. Construction of 18.1 miles of replacement gas main and existing public road layouts. Anyone wishing to testify orally will be welcome to do so. Written comments may be submitted at the hearing. The application, plans, and relevant documents may be viewed by calling the Cape Cod Commission office at 508-362-3828 to schedule an appointment between the hours of 8:30 a.m. and 4:30 p.m. At this time, I would like the applicants to make their presentation, and please come to the podium and give your name for the record.
Good afternoon, Mr. Chair. Excuse me, and Cape Cod Commissioners. My name is Mike Miller. I'm from the law firm of Keegan Worland in Boston.
Thank you.
And we represent Colonial Gas, a company doing business as National Grid on this matter. Excuse me. We have the full project team here today, and I want to introduce in particular Holly Carlson from Epsilon Associates. Holly is the company's outside environmental consultant for a presentation about the project and why we're here today. But we do have, before Holly takes the podium, I just do want to say that we do have a full slate of team members with expertise in various subject matters to the extent you have questions that Holly can answer. So, thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks, Mike. And thank you to all of you as well for taking the time to be here on the Thursday before our beautiful holiday weekend to talk about the Mid-Cape Main replacement. So I'll begin by taking you through the project need.
Excuse me, Holly, can you give us your full name, please?
Oh, sure. Holly Carlson from Epsilon Associates. I'll discuss the project need, really the driving force behind this project, go through some routing design and project design and routing, go through some environmental considerations as well as permitting requirements. National Grid has also performed extensive public outreach for this project, so I'll describe some of that and then wrap up with a discussion of project schedule. So this map is really just to situate you. We're really looking at these orange lines in here on the mid cape. This is the 200 pound per square inch gauge, so the 200 PSIG system. It's in four different towns, Dartmouth, Lewis, Harwich, and Brewster. And so you don't have to strain your eyes too much looking at that map from a distance. This is essentially zooming in on that 200 PSIG system. So this is the existing map. It's 18.1 miles of 6-inch, 8-inch, and 10-inch diameter main. So there are a variety of diameters out here now. Various segments were installed between the 60s and the 1990s. In most cases, this 200 PSIG system is paralleled by a 60 PSIG system, off of which the direct services to customers are located. In some cases, there is no 60 PSIG system, so there are what are known as farm taps, essentially a first cut pressure regulator off of the 200 PSIG line. The National Grid is in the process of eliminating those farm taps. And I'll refer to those a couple of times throughout the presentation. A couple of things I want to point out, really one in particular, is the western side of the route. It begins right at the National Grid South Yarmouth LNG facility, and then continues east from there. So getting into project need a little bit, early in 2014, National Grid received an odor complaint, which led to a series of inspections of the 200 PSIG system. These inspections uncovered 30 gas services that were deemed substandard connected to the 200 PSIG system. Essentially, they didn't have that first cut pressure regulator. They didn't have that farm tap that I just referred to. These substandard service connections were corrected when they were discovered. However, out of 27 welds that were randomly sampled, 9 were found not to meet present-day welding codes. And furthermore, there are some incomplete or erroneous records where there have been some conflicts between the diameter of the main and the ground and the old records from when that main was installed. So for all of these reasons, in the fall of 2014, National Grid reduced the operating pressure to less than 125 PSIG. And in doing so, they imposed a moratorium on new natural gas services and expansion of existing services. So essentially, the main needs to be replaced before that moratorium can be lifted. And the moratorium is largely why we've received some pretty vocal support for this project due to demand for natural gas services. So here is the route of the proposed replacement main. It looks quite similar given the slide you just saw two slides ago for the existing conditions. In fact, the proposed replacement main does follow the existing main in its entirety with one exception. Here, there's an 800-foot stretch on Queen Anne Road, just at the eastern end of the project, where the route does deviate slightly from the existing route. I'm gonna step away from the microphone for just a second so I can point to something on the map. But the existing main follows Queen Anne Road, turns briefly south before turning sharply to the northeast here, versus simply continuing east on Queen Anne Road, which is proposed for the replacement main. This minor change has been made for a couple of reasons. First, it eliminates a couple of sharp bends in the route for the replacement main. And second, the Route 39 rotary is right at this point. The existing main really cuts right through that rotary. But with the proposed replacement main route, we'll essentially come into that rotary and immediately be off of it again. So it does reduce construction period impacts to the Route 39 rotary. So similar to the existing route, this is 18.1 miles. In this case, it is all 12-inch diameter main, so uniform diameter, with one exception. At the western end, there's approximately 1,000 feet of 20-inch diameter. This is on National Grid's property at the South Yarmouth LNG facility. And that's to eliminate a bottleneck that exists at that end of the system currently. But other than that, uniform 12-inch diameter main across the board. The route in its entirety is proposed within the existing roadway layout. It's predominantly beneath pavement, but where it isn't beneath pavement, it's within 10 feet of that pavement, so really right in the shoulder of the road. some previously disturbed areas. Before we move away from the map, there are just a couple other features I'd like to mention. Again, at the western end, here's the South Yarmouth LNG facility. There is one major river crossing on the route, and that's the Bass River, right here between Yarmouth and Dennis. The High Bank Road Bridge spans that river crossing, and the replacement main is proposed to be mounted in a spare utility bay of that bridge. There are also two significant culverted crossings. One is the Herring River here in Harwich, and one is Stony Brook up here on the northern end of the segment you see in orange. This is also the location of the Stony Brook Grist Mill, which you're probably familiar with. We understand it's a pretty popular site, beginning with the herring run in the spring and extending through the busy summer season. The last piece I want to mention is this stretch along Orleans Road. It's about 1.6 miles in length. This stretch was reviewed and was originally proposed as the eastern segment of the Sagamore Line Reinforcement Project. So you're probably familiar with it. The fact that it is now part of this replacement main project negates the need for the eastern segment of the SLRP. This piece, because it was part of that previous project, has already been approved by the Energy Facilities Siting Board. So that has some implications for construction schedule, which I'll get to a little bit later. Now, most of this I actually just went over, again, 18.1 miles. Predominantly 12-inch diameter main, so consistent diameter. It's consistent with present-day pipeline construction standards, and that will also allow National Grid to perform inline inspections. In other words, the pipeline will be piggable. They'll be able to send an inline inspection device through the main. I mentioned that the replacement main follows the route of the existing main. There's no change in land use associated with the project, and it's also efficient to follow the existing route because there's already a network of regulator stations, and the proposed replacement main needs to connect to those regulator stations as well. No new regulator stations are proposed as part of this project. I did mention the one exception to the that one route deviation, about 800 feet on Queen Anne Road. I also mentioned the route is entirely within existing roadway layout, again, predominantly beneath the pavement. Most of the existing main will be abandoned in place, but there are four pieces, which together total just over 11,000 linear feet. These four pieces are proposed for continued use at the lower pressure 60 PSIG. Essentially, they'll fill in the gaps of the 60 PSIG system to eliminate farm taps, those first cut pressure regulators that we talked about before. Those four segments are shown on this map here. So this will simplify system operations. It will also standardize service design to customers. And it negates the need for a future 2-inch or 4-inch main to be installed in these locations to operate at 60 PSIG. So you're avoiding impacts from a future project by using the existing infrastructure. There are a number of environmental considerations, obviously. Because this project is entirely within roadway layout and mostly beneath pavement, there will be no tree clearing. There are also no ACECs on the project route and no direct wetlands impacts. There are areas where the project will pass through previously disturbed buffer zone or riverfront area. And again, by previously disturbed, it's the paved roadway. But where the project does pass through these areas, it will always be beneath the paved surface. So not even in the shoulder, but beneath pavement within buffer zone and riverfront area. There are no impacts to historic or archaeological resources anticipated. We have engaged with an archaeological consultant who's been involved throughout the process. And given the project being proposed within the roadway layout, they are confident that there will be no impacts to those resources. The project does pass through some protected habitats. But again, we're always within 10 feet of the paved surface, so it's actually exempt from review from natural heritage. The project is predominantly proposed below grade. The only above grade infrastructure is associated with some remotely operated valves. In total, four remotely operated valves are proposed. Two are located on the extreme western end of the project on National Grid's property, and two are located pretty much dead center to the project in Harwich. For each of those ROV locations, the above ground infrastructure that's proposed includes two control boxes. You'll see a rendering of what a control box looks like. two control boxes, which will be protected by U-shaped bollards painted the same color, and then a single vent pole, which will be no higher than those control boxes, which will vent from the underground vault. So we'll talk about that in a little more detail. I did mention the water body crossings, Bass River being the only major river crossing. And again, the replacement main will be mounted in a spare utility bay on that bridge. National Grid does believe that no in-water support vessel will be needed for that installation. Certainly, if an in-water support vessel is needed to help in mounting the replacement main, we will coordinate with the harbor masters in both Yarmouth and Dennis. The culverted crossings I mentioned at Herring River and Stony Brook, you'll see a picture in a couple slides here. But the proposed replacement main will simply be installed in the roadbed above those culverts. So it'll be open cut trenching, no impacts to the culverts, no in-water work, no wetlands impacts. The replacement main will simply be within the roadbed. A couple of points to make about construction management. National Grid has been coordinating with municipalities to draft traffic management plans. A series of draft TMPs were included in the DRI exemption application before you. And certainly we're working with municipalities to finalize those TMPs. We're also coordinating with affected businesses and towns regarding construction schedule. I mentioned the Stony Brook Grist Mill earlier. It's a great example because we do certainly realize it's a very busy area, lots of visitors, not too much parking, usually starting late March with the herring run and continuing through the summer. So this is one area where National Grid has chosen not to perform construction during the busy season and just to avoid construction period impacts there. One additional point I do want to make that's not on the slide is there are no special trenchless crossing techniques proposed as part of the project, like jack and bore or horizontal directional drilling. When we did submit the DRI exemption application, there was one trenchless crossing, a jack and bore, that was under consideration at the intersection with Route 28. We've actually consulted with MassDOT on that, and it was decided that a simple open-cut trench installation there would actually have fewer impacts than a jack-and-bore, really because a jack-and-bore pit needs to be bigger. So no trenchless crossing techniques proposed as part of the project. This photograph shows you the underside of the High Bank Road Bridge. Again, the replacement main will simply be installed within a spare utility bay here, and no in-water work is anticipated as being necessary, no in-water support vessel. High Bank Road Bridge is a previously licensed structure under Chapter 91, so we will be seeking a minor modification from MassDOT for this work. These are two photographs of the culvert crossings, Herring River on the left, Stony Brook on the right. Again, no direct wetlands impacts here, no impacts to the culverts themselves, and these were deemed non-Chapter 91 jurisdictional by MassDEP. So no Chapter 91 jurisdiction for these two crossings. This is just a schematic showing how the replacement main will be installed within the roadbed above the culvert. So no impacts to the culvert. And this is a rendering of the control box. So again, two remotely operated valves are proposed in Harwich in the center of the project. And at each of those locations, there will be two of these control boxes protected by bollards, which will protect the boxes from, say, snowplows passing by, and then a single vent pole, no higher than the control box, which will vent from the vault below. We did perform a climate change vulnerability assessment for the project route. That did show the project route has no vulnerabilities from current sea level rise projections of up to 6 feet in the area. The map you see in front of you here shows hurricane storm surge inundation. And you can see, if you look closely, in the upper left, you'll see some limited inundation here on either side of the Bass River crossing, but really no significant inundation across the project route associated with climate change. I mentioned before that National Grid has done quite a bit of public outreach. This has included mailings as well as door-to-door visits with abutters. National Grid has also set up a project-specific website with a dedicated phone number and email address so folks can get answers to their questions in a timely manner. We've also held a number of stakeholder meetings, generously hosted by the Cape Cod Commission staff. And we also held some open houses back in January and are also looking forward to some more open houses this summer, probably in July. Municipal coordination is ongoing. Engineers have been closely coordinating with DPWs as well as water departments in each of the affected municipalities. This is primarily to avoid impacts to existing underground utilities, but also to avoid conflicts with future planned projects. And we're certainly still coordinating with municipalities to finalize the traffic management plans and the construction schedule. So speaking of schedule, we received the final MEPA certificate back in mid-April, and we're looking forward to receiving the rest of our approvals over the next several months. I mentioned earlier that the eastern segment, that 1.6-mile long stretch along Orleans Road, has already received EFSB approval. Due to that, we're hoping to actually begin construction on the eastern segment this fall, while the rest of the construction would begin in the spring. If towns allow fairly significant construction during the summer months, construction could be over as early as August 2018. But if construction during the summer is more restricted, then April of 2019 is a more realistic completion date. I'm not sure if you'd like to take questions now or after the staff presentation.
I think we'll take the staff presentation first.
Okay, great. Thank you so much.
Thank you. All right, at this time I'll call on John to present the draft decision.
Yeah, thank you. Good afternoon. I'm going to focus basically on the commission's regulatory role in a project like this rather than a description of the project, which I think was ably given to you by Ms. Carlson. To start with, this project does trigger mandatory DRI review because it requires the preparation of an environmental impact report under the Massachusetts Environmental Policy Act. In response to that, National Grid has submitted a DRI exemption application rather than a DRI application. For your consideration, staff has prepared a draft decision that's in your materials. If voted for approval, it would approve the DRI exemption application and no further commission review would be required for the project. Staff suggests that applying for an exemption in this particular case and approving the exemption is appropriate. Again, in this particular case, a DRI exemption should be sparingly granted. They've always been sparingly granted by this board, but in particular cases like this one, they're entirely appropriate. Based on that, staff would recommend approval of this draft decision. An analysis of the exemption application really begins with an understanding of DRI jurisdiction in general, and then considering the legal standard required for the board to grant a DRI exemption that is contained in the Act and regulations. A DRI is in definition a project that, because of its magnitude, is presumed to create significant regional development issues, that is, issues in more than one Cape town. The standard for granting a DRI exemption, or an exemption from DRI review, is that based on the particular location, character, and environmental impacts of or effects of a project, that project will not have significant impacts on the various values and purposes which are laid out in Section 1 of the Act outside the municipality in which the development is to be located. So the basic inquiry here is whether there are significant impacts on resources protected in Section 1 of the Act. And if so, whether those impacts are regional in nature. Based on a review of the draft decision, you'll note that it's staff's opinion, reduced to writing in that decision, that there are no significant impacts to those resources that are protected in the Act. And any impacts that do exist are not regional in nature, inasmuch as this project is located in four towns, two on the mid-Cape, two on the lower Cape. Just by way of background, the project, and I think this is important to the analysis of the exemption itself, the project didn't trigger any other DRI threshold than the one associated with the Massachusetts Environmental Policy Act. But for that trigger, the project wouldn't come under the jurisdiction of the Cape Cod Commission. This is really a project of a type that happens every day on Cape Cod. It's utility work within a road layout that towns regularly permit, oversee, and administer every day without involvement by the Cape Cod Commission. And further, this required the preparation of an environmental impact report under MEPA, really for technical reasons that are unique to state regulations. Because the pipe diameter is increasing and therefore allows more pressure, though the operating capacity isn't intended to be increased at all, This was considered a new project under MEPA and for purposes of the environmental or the Energy Facility Siting Board. So the operating capacity is intended to stay at what it's permitted at today, but because of the increase in the diameter of the pipe, there's a theoretical increase in capacity. Thus, the state considered it a new project and required the filing and preparation of an environmental impact report. But for that, this would be a project that, again, happens every day, wouldn't be subject to Cape Cod Commission DRI jurisdiction. Now that we're here talking about the project, though, this project has been designed to mitigate, minimize, or avoid permanent regional impacts to protected resources, primarily because the replacement main is located in parallel to the existing main, in disturbed areas, under pavement, or within 10 feet of pavement, though mostly under pavement, within public rights of way. The existing main, where it won't be reused in those sections that were discussed, will be abandoned in place. And where there might be impacts, they tend to be localized and temporary in nature, such as traffic effects that have to do with the construction time period. And even with that, those temporary or localized type impacts, National Grid has proposed practices to minimize or mitigate these local or temporary impacts, such as traffic management planning that will be pursued and undertaken with town officials. As a side note here, since I'm discussing transportation, those temporary construction impacts are not something that the commission usually gets involved with in application of the RPP to DRI projects anyway. You know, I've discussed impacts, but this design actually goes further than not creating regional significant impacts, which is the primary standard that the commission needs to apply when entertaining a DRI exemption application. Staff suggests it goes further. It's actually consistent with the RPP, local development bylaws, and local comprehensive plans as applicable. Positive letters to this effect have been received from all the towns involved with the project, Yarmouth, Dennis, Brewster, and Harwich. The project also provides regional benefits in that it updates a critical piece of regional infrastructure. So not only is it making the existing main more safe and reliable, but this is also a forward-looking project in that the construction will ensure this safe and reliable piece of infrastructure stays so into the future. There's a particular analysis in the draft decision on some certain RPP issue areas that staff felt were especially material to the project: natural resources, water resources, transportation, community character. The importance of discussion in these particular areas is it underscores the lack of permanent regional impacts on protected resources under the Act. This project benefited from the entire process that led up to the exemption application that you see before you. And it really approximated what an applicant would normally do during a DRI review process. There was a stakeholder process with meetings hosted by the Cape Cod Commission. There was a full MEPA process. That is, it went through the entire environmental impact report stage and got a certificate on the environmental impact report. The importance of this is it led to a level of public transparency and public input that actually benefited the project. It led to an iterative and dynamic planning and design process where comments through especially the MEPA process, were received on the design. Some concerns were received as well. And those concerns or comments were addressed in the project as it proceeded through the MEPA process. Another way to look at a DRI exemption application also may be what is the benefit or what is the necessity of going through the DRI review process? I'd suggest in this case that many of the important reasons to undertake DRI review, such as public input, that iterative design process where you will get comments on a design, it will be incorporated in the design, have already occurred. So I don't think there's a great reason to undertake DRI review on this. In fact, what it may result in is further delay of the project. In order to and it probably serves the region better, probably benefits the region better if this project were to commence sooner than later. The sooner this project commences, the sooner that moratorium can be lifted, the sooner existing and new customers can be served. The project still has to receive local approvals and certain state approvals. So the towns will certainly be looking at this. They'll certainly be looking at the project in terms of those temporary construction impacts to the transportation network as well. So in closing, staff suggests the project meets the standard for the DRI exemption and recommends approval of the draft written DRI exemption decision to the commission. So if I can answer any questions as the commission discusses this, I would be happy to do so.
At this time, are there any questions from any of the commissioners? Elizabeth.
Thank you. I just had a question about scheduling. Do you have to do the whole project at once, or can you do one town part and then one town part? Because when you start getting into this time of year, the last thing we want is any work on their own. It's bad enough that we're doing that on 6A right now, which totally disrupts everything. But it's work that has to be done. So when you come to each town, are you now going to go through the selectmen or the planning board, or how are you doing that from now on?
Please state your name for the record.
Tom O'Keen with National Grid. So we're working with all the towns and we're trying to figure out the hours and time of season to work. So if it's a busy street in the summertime, we're gonna try to stay off that. We're working with the towns with that. So the idea is to go from Yarmouth down, but we're still in the design phase of figuring out what the best way would be. But generally we're working with all the towns to limit the traffic and congestion during the summer.
Thank you.
Ernie.
Thank you. While I understand that the individual towns give your permits and your regulations, and formerly being a DPW director, I've got a couple of things. While I completely understand and agree that this is well needed, I have some problems in the construction phases, as it's just been brought up slightly, but the widths of the paved, of the cut areas in a repavement, that's something that I understand. Your trench is not that wide, not really that deep, but in sections where you're traveling down a heavily traveled road, it causes a problem. And I would hope that the towns in the permitting process and your company agree to how you're going to satisfy that road surface so that it does not become uneven and dangerous. That's a problem I've had for years. Also, the other thing is an impact on a bridge and crossing a bridge and the age of the bridge and your brand new pipe being put in. And that's something that really seriously needs to be looked at, because the bridge you may be using, your construction methods, your construction system is fine, but I need the absolute certainty that the bridge is okay and how long is it going to last. So another thing I'm hoping that individual towns are looking into things like that. And John, I understand what you said. I also feel that some of these become issues. And a system this long, which is absolutely necessary, I think we need to be a little bit cautious in our sitting here and our talking about it to protect that refinished surface in those areas that, you know, can become a daily problem for us later on. Also have a problem with daily exercises. We've got some good contractors and we've got some, well, contractors. But anyway, when you're doing this type of work and there again you're being followed repeatedly by vehicles, I would hope that your scheduling during the day is, you know, is it at best putting some kind of a temporary surface down in the areas that you disturb. So I think that, and I those are some of the things that are my concerns that I feel this commission should be concerned about. And the last thing I have, and the one that bothers me the most, is abandon in place. What abandon in place means is now we're going to have two structures underground, and there's no more use of that space. And I got a real problem with that. That's something we need to talk about in the future. In giving up these areas, I do have a real problem with abandon in place. With that, I don't have anything else to say other than I understand completely how needed this project is, and good luck.
Thank you, Ernie.
Thank you, Ernie. David?
I too have issues with the project and passing, you know, accepting this DRI with its exemptions. My issues, one of my first issues is that the tribe, to my knowledge, has not been involved with the review of this project in under Section 106. They are obligated to in looking over some of the jurisdictional agencies that are involved with the review process and permitting. It seems to me that Section 106 should be followed with this project. We haven't had a chance to thoroughly review the project. There's a lot of other agencies that haven't completed their reviews or the permits are forthcoming, and that makes me a little uneasy. One of which is the MEPA. It doesn't seem like they've finished theirs. There's further review of the project. My main concern is the abandoning in place. I have concerns with how does that affect the environment, because now you have a cavity underground that you're not filling it with, I haven't heard anybody saying that they will fill it with flowable fill or anything, so it's just an empty cavity that can carry water. The water's gonna carry any residue from the gas pipe somewhere. I'd have concern with that, leaving it there for years. I don't know the present condition of the pipe as it is, so I would be interested in reading MEPA's conditions and their comments to that. That's pretty much all I have. I would ask that they have, as a condition to this permit, that the tribe is involved with the review process to ensure that the historical sites of significance and archaeological sites are not to be impacted under its construction. Oftentimes, the roadways go right over surfaces. Down that end of the Cape, a lot of the road surfaces, they don't have structural fill. They were done early on, and there's minimal disturbance, sometimes very just superficial covering of the roadway, compacted present conditions of the soil, and then just overlaying it with asphalt. So, especially on secondary roads, that's often the case. So as far as the disturbed area, I'm not comforted by that assumption when discussing impacting significance, areas of significance to the tribe.
Am I able to respond to a couple of those comments?
Yes, please.
Great. So Holly Carlson from Epsilon Associates. Just regarding the historic and archaeological resource piece, we did engage an archaeological consultant on the project to assess the project route. Also, of course, with the knowledge that there are existing underground utilities along most of the route. So there's existing disturbance, not just associated with the roadbed, of course. But with Section 106, there's no federal permit trigger for Section 106 for review of this particular project. Although MHC was involved in the MEPA review, MHC received a copy of the expanded environmental notification form. The agency chose not to comment, which, as you know, they do routinely given how busy they are if they have no concerns with the project. But in terms of MEPA review is complete. So we received a final MEPA certificate back in April. We submitted an expanded environmental notification form and a single EIR and completed the review with the certificate in April. Is someone able to speak to abandonment of the pipe?
The EPA, I read where the EPA has jurisdiction over this project as well.
The project does require a NPDES permit. That's the only federal piece. Wendy, would you like to speak to the... Sure.
Good afternoon. Wendy Levine, I'm an in-house attorney at National Grid. A NPDES notice of intent is going to be required for the work. On the forms, there's a certification, and we intend to check the certification that, based on our archaeologists' work, that there's no potential to affect any cultural or historic resources. That being said, we are certainly happy to meet with the tribe, go over the project with the tribe, give the tribe notification when the work is going to commence on the different segments of the project, to provide any additional information that you'd like on the project.
Yeah, I'd like to talk with you on that for a little
while. Dave, turn on your mic, please.
I would like to meet with you folks, with the tribe, to discuss the project further.
We're more than pleased to do that. Well, certainly afterwards we can exchange contact information and we'll set something up.
Thank you. Is there anybody going to speak to the abandoned in place issue?
Tom O'Keefe, National Grid. So our typical method is to purge the main out of service and install end caps on the end so no water or debris gets into it. We haven't had issues, but that's the typical. What we do, the LR, to remove it would be a greater impact to the environment because you basically have to dig an exact same trench to remove it. It's more soil removal, more asphalt removal, more pollution because you're doing more work. So I don't know if that'd be beneficial. For the paving, we are working with the cities, with all the different towns. We will be doing grinded inlays. And we're trying to get all the requirements down so we will make sure the road is back to the condition it was or better, so that we're in the process of that. For the bridge is owned by Yarmouth and Dennis, and BHB is the consulting engineer that is doing the design in the load, and they work for the town, so they're in the process now of determine agreeing to it, I believe. Is that right, Mike?
That's correct.
So they are working with the two towns to finalize the design and get the sign off.
Yeah, basically, you know, with regard to the abandonment, that's just something that's, you know, I've dealt with for a long, long, long time and have had very much difficulties with it. And I appreciate your explanation of the removal of it and replacement of the the surface and the ground underneath. Of course it would be extremely expensive, and I understand that, but there's going to be a point in time where steel pipe and any other kind of pipe does lose its conductivity, and we're in trouble. And at some point in time, this commission's got to talk about how we're going to deal with stuff like that. I appreciate exactly what you said. I've seen a lot of work done by the gas company. I've been a project manager for a long time. You do a very good job. You're very, very consistent. And I'm really proud of you as a utility. But the pipe abandonment is a problem I have, and I'm sorry.
Okay. Thank you.
What are the best practices of associated with replacing pipe? Is that a best practice to abandon in place?
Yes, that is the best practice.
Ernie, I'd like to add too that the bridge was recently replaced. Okay. It's not that old.
Well, that's good, because I get some of these structures that we're looking around today, and you pick up the paper every day and it replacing, bridges. We've got some pretty nasty bridges out there. Okay, good. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Yes, Joe. Thank you. I'd like to support my colleague's concern about abandonment.
I think it is turned on the screen. Support my colleague's concern about abandonment in place, and I know utilities prefer to abandon archaic utilities in place. It's much more economical for them. But this is Cape Cod, and the only corridors that we have for future use for utilities are really kind of the public right-of-ways along our streets. So I really support both what they're saying. And I also wonder with the ROV control boxes, if it's possible to paint them factory painted, a matte black finish so that they blend in more with the landscape, particularly in historic areas, because the gray really does stand out. I mean, it's shown in the picture. And I know, you know, in California and other places, they're doing that. So I would encourage you to consider that.
Thank you. Kevin?
Thank you. I just had some questions about the moratorium. I think that's had a significant impact on construction, which speaks to the need for the project. Given your timeline, when would you expect that moratorium to be lifted?
Good afternoon. My name is Chris Connolly. I represent engineering for National Grid. So as we proceed with construction, we're going to evaluate our opportunities to reduce or carve out areas of the moratorium as we get new pipe installed and gassed into service. That'll be our opportunity on an annual basis to take a look to see if there's a way to lessen the impact to the community and allow some limited growth as the project is being constructed. Without that, we would have to wait until the entire project is fully in service, which, as Holly mentioned earlier in her presentation, at the earliest could be 2018, and if at the latter could be, you know, sometime in 2019. But we would take that opportunity as work gets constructed and as new sections of pipe are put into service to carve out areas of the moratorium, really from west to east, which would provide the greatest benefit to our customers.
So what is it that you have to evaluate or determine to decide whether or not sections can it can be lifted in those sections?
Right, so great question. So as we finalize our plan for executing the construction, we'll look at assigning where our resources are going to start the work. And then as we evaluate how much work we get completed in a given year prior to the winter heating season, that'll be our opportunity to review our hydraulic models with the new maintenance service to see what opportunities we have to carve out that moratorium.
Great, thank you.
Jackie?
Yes, I would hope that you're coordinating with Mass DOT, Department of Transportation, so that you do your work first and they repave second.
So we have limited impact with Mass DOT. The only Mass DOT crossing that we have is Route 28 at Depot Street, I believe it is, at Depot Street. So we will be coordinating those activities with Mass DOT, but more importantly, we'll be communicating and coordinating very closely with the municipalities for their paving schedules. And to the point made earlier about street restoration and paving, that's part of the ongoing discussions that we're having with the municipalities, the DPWs, the town engineers, about how the final restoration is going to be accomplished.
Great, thank you.
Any other questions from commissioners? We'll go to comments by federal officials. Are there any federal officials that wish to comment? Any state officials? Any local officials? Is there anybody in the public? Was there a sign-in sheet for this? Please.
I didn't see a sign-in sheet. Good afternoon. I'm Wendy Northcross, CEO of the Cape Cod Chamber of Commerce. We've been very impressed with the transparency and the communications from NGRID and with the advisory committee that the Cape Cod Commission put together. So we stand here today in support of this project for obvious reasons. We recently completed a survey of our members that we do annually, and in the area of economic development, the issue of energy price and availability has now risen into the top five concerns of our members. So certainly we want to be sensitive to that. But we have been on the record as supporting this and trying to have concurrent review and an accelerated review at every possible moment. So we ask you to support this DRI exemption. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Is there any other public comment? I will now open it up for commission discussion. Is there any further discussion from the commission? Jack?
Just a comment, Mr. Chairman. I was present at the Yarmouth Board of Selectmen meeting on May 3rd, and I have in front of me the accepted minutes of the meeting, and I was always impressed by the amount of cooperation they said they would keep with the town. They said they've already been talking to the DPW Police Department and town administrators. They were also questioned on a couple of occasions about how the repavement would go. It would go from the center line to the curb, or from curb to curb. And they stated emphatically that they would comply with whatever the town's directions were. The town put those conditions on that they repave from curb to curb, they would do that.
Thank you, Jack. Any other discussion? I would just add a comment that National Grid has been doing extensive main replacements in Howichin and Dennis and in Yarmouth over the last probably year and a half. And they do put in a temporary pavement when they finish laying a section. And then just recently they came back and widened that trench, did a very good trench repair. I was in the water utility business for a long time, and I know a good repair when I see one, and they did an excellent job.
Yeah, and I have to agree. I've been working with National Grid for years and other utilities, and they do a very good job.
Mr. Chairman, move we close the public hearing.
I have a motion. Is there
second?
And motion and a second. Any discussion on the motion to close the public hearing? All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Any abstentions? The motion carries. I would now entertain a motion to adopt a draft written DRI exemption decision for the project.
Mr. Park?
So moved.
So moved.
It's moved and seconded. Any discussion on a motion? Okay, it's moved to adopt the draft written DRI exemption decision for the project. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed?
Aye.
And any abstentions? The motion carries. Thank you. You're welcome to stay. We're just going to wrap up our meeting. But you can also leave if you want to leave. I will wait a minute or so.
I think that should stay.
I guess we can continue. Are there any topics not reasonably anticipated by the chair that you would like to bring up?
Mr. Chair, if I may, I'd just like to comment on attendance recently. I think the attendance by commission members has been pretty good in the past few meetings. Excellent today. Thank you.
Thank you, Jim. Any other items? Do I have a motion for adjournment?
So moved.
One more.
Second? All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Abstentions? Meeting's adjourned.